Hey, it's Medicosis Perfectionatus, where medicine makes perfect sense, and today we'll talk about Sjogren Syndrome, a clinical triad of dry eyes, dry mouth, and inflammatory arthritis. This is my series on rheumatology, and let's get started. The survey that was available on my channel is here, and the winner is coagulation and bleeding disorders. We'll talk about this in May. This does not mean that I will stop talking about rheumatology and biochemistry. I'll just focus more on coagulation. What's the difference between Sjogren syndrome and Sicca syndrome? By the way, the answer was in the previous video. But let's do it again. Sjogren syndrome is a triad of dry eyes, dry mouth, and inflammatory arthritis. Instead of dry eyes, you can say keratoconjunctivitis Sicca or xerophthalmia. And instead of dry mouth, you can say xerostomia. And inflammatory arthritis the same. That was Sjogren syndrome. Sicca syndrome has the dry eyes, the dry mouth, but no arthritis. So, Sjogren is dry eyes, dry mouth, arthritis. Sicca syndrome, dry eyes, dry mouth, no arthritis. So here is case number 340. So where is case 1 and 2? They are in previous videos in this playlist titled Rheumatology. So let's do it. It's the same patient, and then we have three questions. A 78-year-old female comes in complaining of pain in the left shoulder. The pain started 7 months ago. She denies any dryness of the eyes or the mouth. She has a history of hyperparathyroidism, milk alkali syndrome, scleroderma, and dermatomyositis. Arthrocentesis of her left shoulder revealed very small crystals that appear as red clumps using alizarin red stain. Question number one, what's the most likely diagnosis? Now please pause. And here is the answer. Some of you will say, oh, he's talking today about Sjogren syndrome, so Sjogren is the answer. Oh, shut up. I got you. Osteoarthritis. No, because osteoarthritis doesn't have crystals that stain using the alizarin red special stain. Gout. Gouty crystals will not be necessarily in the shoulder. Most inflammatory gouty attacks are the acute gout in the big toe, not in the left shoulder. Also, the crystals of gout do not stain with alizarin red. They are monosodium urate crystals, and they do not need any special stains. You can just see them. Especially under plain polarized microscopy. Cool. CPPD disease. This is pseudogout, calcium pyrophosphate dehydrate crystal deposition disease. Is this the correct answer? No. They do not require a special stain called alizarin red. So the answer here is hydroxyapatite arthropathy, which is known by some doofuses as pseudogout, which is kind of redundant. Okay, same patient, second question. What's the chemical nature of these crystals? Are they monosodium urate crystals, basic calcium phosphate crystals, calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate crystals, calcium oxalate, or cholesterol crystals? Please pause. And the answer is, since this is hydroxyapatite crystals and the crystals stain with alizarin red, these crystals are basic calcium freaking phosphate. And we have talked about this disease in a former video in this glorious playlist called Rheumatology. What's their birefringence? We're talking about the crystals. Are these crystals strongly positive birefringent, strongly negative birefringent, weakly positive, weakly negative, or non-birefringent? Please pause. And the answer here is non-birefringent. So where is gout here? Gout was strongly negative. So this is freaking gout. How about pseudogout or CPPD disease? CPPD disease was weakly positive. So this is CPPD disease. The non-birefringent is the hydroxyapatite arthropathy. Now forget pseudo-freaking gout and let's talk about Sjogren, baby Sjogren. Would you consider Sjogren arthritis non-inflammatory or inflammatory arthritis? The answer is inflammatory, baby. And that's why ESR and CRP are expected to be high. If you have watched my previous videos in this playlist, you know that inflammatory arthritis such as rheumatoid and Mr. Sjogren have the cardinal signs of inflammation, redness, hotness, swelling, pain, and loss of function. You have symmetrical freaking arthritis. Right side is the same as the left side. It's usually worse in the morning. ESR and CRP are expected to be high because it's inflammatory. Would you consider Sjogren syndrome as an autoimmune disease? Abso-freaking-lutely. But we have two types of autoimmune diseases. Organ-specific, which just destruct one organ, like Hashimoto thyroiditis, which destroys your thyroid only. And we have systemic autoimmune diseases, which destroy your entire body, such as the ugly rheumatoid, the nasty scleroderma, the sleazy, abhorrent lupus, and the freaking Sjogren. So Sjogren is a systemic autoimmune disease. Whenever you hear the word autoimmune, you think of autoantibodies. Autoantibodies are antibodies against the auto, against the self, against yourself. Where do these autoantibodies come from? Like any antibodies in your blood, they came from the plasma cell. Where did the plasma cell come from? It came from the glorious B lymphocyte. Where did the B lymphocyte come from? It came from a lymphoblast. Where did the lymphoblast come from? It came from a pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell inside your bone marrow. So, Sjogren syndrome. Sjogren is inflammatory. Sjogren is symmetric. Sjogren is autoimmune, and it's not organ-specific. It is systemic. Sjogren is non-erosive, and that's a huge difference between Sjogren and freaking rheumatoid. Rheumatoid is nasty. It's an erosive arthritis, which means it destroys your joints like a severe destruction. But Sjogren is non-erosive. How do you know if it's erosive or non-erosive? Do a freaking x-ray. Do you think Sjogren's arthritis is acute or chronic? Of course it's a chronic disease. It's true that it can have acute flares, but the disease itself, it's a chronic arthritis. Let's define Sjogren syndrome. It's a lymphocyte-mediated autoimmune disease characterized by autoimmune destruction of your minor salivary glands, and that's why it gives you dry mouth, the lacrimal glands, dry eyes, the joints, leading to inflammatory arthritis, and these are the famous characteristics of the clinical triad of Sjogren syndrome. Please beware, many books will not mention type 4 hypersensitivity. I personally don't like to call it type 4 hypersensitivity, but if somebody asks you what type of hypersensitivity is Sjogren, answer type 4. But please be careful, I've told you that's an autoimmune disease. So if it's an autoimmune disease, it's gonna involve also the B lymphocytes. So technically you have two types of cells involved in Sjogren syndrome. You have the B lymphocytes because it's an autoimmune, and you have the T lymphocytes because it's arguably a type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. But Harrison does not say T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes and type 4 and autoimmune and all of this stuff. Harrison's put it this way in a completely eloquent fashion. It's a disease of lymphocytic infiltration, talking about type 4 hypersensitivity, and a B lymphocyte hyperreactivity, talking of its autoimmunity. Sjogren syndrome epidemiology, middle-aged females between 40 and 60, female-to-male ratio about 10 to 1. So on your exam, when they present you a patient with Sjogren, it's going to be a female, just by playing odds. Please note that Sjogren is associated with fibromyalgia, again commoner in females. How about gout? Commoner in males. Sjogren is associated with HLA-DQ, HLA-DR subtypes. We have talked about them before in this rheumatology playlist. Sjogren is associated with other autoimmune diseases. Imagine my shock. Any autoimmune disease is usually associated with other autoimmune disease, such as what? Rheumatoid and lupus. So can I see a patient with rheumatoid and Sjogren at the same time? It's absolutely true. Which one started first? It's very hard to know unless you know the patient's history. Sometimes you can start with rheumatoid and the rheumatoid leads to secondary Sjogren syndrome, so to speak, or you can start with Sjogren and Sjogren will end up with secondary rheumatoid, so to speak. Can you have a patient with lupus and Sjogren? Yes. Can you have a patient with rheumatoid and lupus? Yes. Actually, we call it rupus. Lupus. Sjogren may be associated with EBV, Epstein-Barr virus, CMV, cytomegalovirus, and HCV, hepatitis C virus. The old classification was like this, primary Sjogren and secondary Sjogren. Primary was de novo, secondary was if it came like after rheumatoid, we call it secondary Sjogren. No more, this classification is archaic. If your professor still uses it, it means your professor hasn't opened a textbook since man walked on moon. So what's wrong with this classification? It doesn't freaking matter. First of all, how do you know? How do you know that the rheumatoid came first and then the Sjogren, not the Sjogren first and then the rheumatoid? So there is no point. And how would you manage primary Sjogren and secondary Sjogren? Like, exactly the same. It has nothing to do with the etiology. It has to do with the severity. So this classification is just a waste of ink. Clinically, Sjogren, triad of dry eyes, dry mouth, and arthritis. If you are a mediocre medical student, just memorize these three: dry eyes, dry mouth, and arthritis. But if you are a superb medical student, you need to memorize another eight. That's an octagon, baby. So let's start with the triad, which is more important. Keratoconjunctivitis sicca, same as dry eyes, same as xerophthalmia. The patient will describe it as, "Doctor, I feel like there is dirt in my eyes." And then dry mouth, xerostomia. I cannot chew a dry cracker. I cannot swallow a dry cracker. I can just cannot eat it. Why? Because the mouth is dry. Inflammatory arthritis is symmetrical, non-erosive, with something called Jacoud's deformity. The octagon involves the nerves, the lungs, the skin, the GI, the GU, the vagina, hematology, cardiology, glands, including lymph node and thyroid. And of course, salivary glands as well. That's why the patient had a dry mouth. The octagon, please. But before the octagon, remember the triad: dry eyes, dry mouth, arthritis. The octagon: neuro, CNS, and PNS. CNS, depression; PNS, neuropathy. Respiratory system: upper respiratory system and lower respiratory tract, including the lung. It's usually a restrictive lung disease, which is an interstitial pulmonary fibrosis or an interstitial lung disease. The skin: we had dry mouth and dry eyes. Also, we have dry skin called xerosis cutis. Cutis is skin. Xerosis is a condition of dryness. Raynaud's phenomenon: it's patriotic, red, white, and blue. But it starts as white, then it becomes blue, then it becomes red. This is Raynaud's phenomenon. The GI, dysphagia. Why? Esophageal dysmotility, very similar to Mrs. Scleroderma. Gastritis and celiac disease. Cardio, CVS disease, and pericarditis. Glands. Remember your lacrimal glands, your salivary glands, minor, and the lymph nodes and the thyroid. Lymph nodes, lymphoma. What type? Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Please be specific. MALToma, mucosa-associated lymphatic tissue lymphoma, which is a marginal zone lymphoma. Is it a B-cell or a T-cell? It's a B-cell. Is it non-Hodgkin's or Hodgkin's? It's non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Thyroid is autoimmune thyroid. That is because Sjogren is an autoimmune disease. Hematology, anemia can happen, leukopenia can happen, hypogammaglobulinemia can happen, monoclonal gammopathy, which is similar to multiple freaking myeloma. Genitourinary, kidney and vagina. Kidney, RTA type 1, renal tubular acidosis type 1. Is this the proximal tubule or the distal tubule? Distal. Type 1 is distal. Type 2 is proximal. We're talking here about the distal. And as well as tubulointerstitial nephritis. The vagina is dry, itchy, and there is dyspareunia, which is painful intercourse because the vagina is dry, because this disease is an autoimmune, ugly freaking disease that affects all of the glands, including the glands that are responsible for lubrication. For the next 24 hours only, my antibiotics course and my cardiac pharmacology course are on sale. The triad: dry eyes, dry mouth, arthritis. In Sjogren, there are autoantibodies and there are lymphocytes. They destroy the minor salivary glands. When there is no salivary glands, we do not have amylase to convert polysaccharides into monosaccharides, and this will lead to xerostomia, dry mouth. Dry mouth will make you thirsty, polydipsia, which will lead to drinking lots of water, and then polyuria, increased urine volume. Xerostomia will lead to candida infection in your mouth, sialadenitis, which is inflammation and infection of the salivary glands, dental caries, and periodontal disease. What's the difference between dental and periodontal? I am not a dentist, but here is how I understand it. Here is your nice teeth or tooth. This tooth, when it has a problem, we call this dental. But between a tooth and another tooth, there is a space, and this is the periodontal tissue. These autoantibodies will also destroy your lacrimal gland, decreasing the tears and leading to keratoconjunctivitis sicca or xerophthalmia, which is dry eye. This can lead to keratitis, which is inflammation of the cornea, corneal ulcers and eyelid infections, the famous blepharitis. So we have talked about dry eyes and dry mouth. Let's talk about arthritis. The arthritis, Before we continue, we have two types of inflammatory arthritis. We have the rheumatoid deformities that you see in rheumatoid arthritis and the Jacoud's deformity that you see in Sjogren and lupus. What's the difference? Rheumatoid deformities occur in rheumatoid. Oh, you don't say. They are erosive, but the Jacoud's deformities are non-erosive. How do I know? X-ray. Rheumatoid deformities are non-reducible. If you, as a doctor, press on the patient's nodules, you will not be able to straighten the finger back to normal. But in Jacoud's deformity, they are reducible. They yield to pressure. Just press on them and the patient's hand can return back to normal. And then the patient and the medical student will think that this is magic. In the next video, I'll teach you how to diagnose Sjogren. In the previous video, we had this picmonic about Sjogren syndrome. It has everything you need to know. The dry eyes, the dry mouth, the arthritis, the increased risk of lymphoma, the SSA and SSBO2 antibodies, and even the Schirmer test. The previous slide was from this website, picmonic. The link is in the description. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and click on the join button. You can support me here or here. Go to picmonic.com/VIP hookup/medicosis and they will hook you up. Thank you for watching. As always, be safe, stay happy, and study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionist, where medicine makes perfect sense.